Well, our subject today, not for milk drinkers. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 2. There the Bible says, "I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hereto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able." The Apostle Paul loved the church at Corinth. He personally labored very hard for them. And yet they were perhaps the most discouraging church that he ministered to, as they seemed to be always slow to learn, slow to come into line. And he said that, "I've given you the milk. You weren't ready for the heavy meat of the food of the Word of God." But later, writing in Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 12, Paul said this, "For when, for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat." Today, friends, it's time to move to a meat diet. Did you get it?
Amen.
It's time to move to a vegan meat diet.
There you go.
Meat representing the stronger food. A diet that is so fortified with the Word of God that, friends, we cannot be moved and we will not be tossed around to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Today we're going to be discussing and talking about a subject that will be touchy for some, disturbing and perhaps unsettling for others. But I want us to be grounded in truth and not to lose our faith when it is challenged, or when we think that our faith is being uprooted and destroyed before our very eyes. Perhaps even worse is the concept that our faith has been slowly and subtly changed, and we have changed with it and not realized what has happened, and we have drifted out into the ocean of doubt and confusion, and yet think in reality we are now closer to the heavenly harbor.
Yes.
Jesus speaks about the importance of truth in John 17:17. He says, "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth." It is through the truth of the Word of God, friends, that we will all be sanctified and brought into harmony with God and His great law. And therefore, to turn away from truth, from the faith that was once delivered to the saints, is dangerous. Turning away from truth is defined in the Bible as something called apostasy. And God repeatedly warns His people against turning away from the truth and the danger that is therein. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5 and 6, the Apostle Paul says, "Examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates? But I trust that ye shall know that we are not reprobates." And it's my great prayer for each one of us that what Paul has written that we have just read will be fulfilled in us, that we will not be reprobates, that the truth will be in us and will be abiding in us. Writing to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verses 20 and 21, the Apostle Paul wrote, "O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust. Avoid profane and vain babblings in opposition of science falsely so called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Grace be with thee. Amen." Some have erred concerning the faith. And Paul says, you beware, be careful. In Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1, he says, "Therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip." Have we heard some wonderful news, friends? Is the Advent message true?
Amen.
Has God given to His people a truth that admits of no compromise?
Amen.
Absolutely.
Then we ought not to let it slip. In Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 12, "Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God." We might say that we're worshiping God today. We might say that we're serving God more fully and completely than ever. We might say that our minds have been opened and enlightened more than ever before. But friends, we could be as verily following Baals, the children of Israel, if we're not following the true God, if we're not following Him in His way, if we're not receiving His word. Because, you know, we call Jesus Lord. Lord means master, the one that we serve. But yet, if we refuse to obey His word, If we refuse to accept the testimony that he has sent to us, can we truly call him Lord? Can we truly be following him and his Father? Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 35, the Apostle Paul says, "Cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward." And so it's no wonder that we are told to earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered to the saints in Jude 3. In fact, Paul says to sharply rebuke those who bear false witness. In Titus chapter 1 and verse 10 and 11, 12, and 13, Paul says this, "For there are many unruly and vain talkers, deceivers, especially they of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not, for filthy lucre's sake. One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said, 'The Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, slow bellies.'" And then he says this, "This witness is true. Wherefore rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith." Now, we may not be dealing with people who are today the circumcision. We may not be dealing with Cretans today and such, but there's a principle here, isn't there, in this verse? That those who are teaching false things, those who are leading people astray, he says, rebuke them sharply. Now, it's interesting that he says that they may be sound in the faith. And that word sound, it literally means to be healthy. To be healthy. To be sound in your faith means to be healthy in your faith. And the purpose of rebuke is not to put someone down. It's not to demean someone. The purpose is to help those who have erred to have a sound or healthy faith. The ultimate goal of rebuke, even sharp rebuke, is to save the one who is in error. Interestingly, the word sharp in this verse comes from a word that doesn't mean to be sharp in a critical or cutting sense. It comes from a Greek word that literally means to cut. And the Adventist Bible commentary, for instance, has this comment on it. It says, "As the surgeon's knife cuts away diseased tissue in order that sound health may result, so the words and discipline of Titus and the Cretan elders are to cut away that which endangers the future of the church." And so sometimes it's like the person who gets gangrene, and it's just first in the toe. We want to take the toe off. "No, don't do that." But then it goes to the foot. "Well, don't take my foot off." And it goes to the leg. "Oh, I can't live without my leg." But then they die. Because that which was wrong wasn't cut out. It might seem painful, but it was necessary for that person to live. And when we accept false doctrine, friends, it's got to be cut out. It's just that simple. The Apostle Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 7, he says, "I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith." He kept the faith. And we've talked about the faith of Jesus, and how in one of its main applications, it represents the body of beliefs that we as Christians have. And Paul says, "I've kept the faith. I've been obedient to that faith." 2 Timothy 4:7. And in 1 Timothy 6:12, he says that we are to fight the good fight of faith. That's what he says to Timothy. And I ask you the question today, can we do any less? Can we do any less? Not only, of course, in what we teach and preach, but in what we live, friends. In what we live. Can we do any less? But I'd like to say, and I'd like to propose to you, that we cannot keep the faith. We cannot fight the good fight of faith if we don't even know what the faith is. Or if we become confused on it. It will be impossible, friends, to study and know the truth without time in our Bibles and time in thought and prayer with the Word of God. And then we can obey the command of Peter, as given in 1 Peter 3:15, where he says, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear." So we should have an understanding of what we believe as a people, right? And we should be able to share that understanding with other people. Amen. Now, the three angels' messages makes us, friends, a distinct people. This is what makes us who we are. And Revelation chapter 14, verse 12, those three angels' messages, they culminate with the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And this is a people that are prophesied, that are called a remnant. And Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17, you know the verse. The dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and what else? And they had the testimony of Jesus Christ. And Revelation chapter 19 and verse 10, we're told that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Now it is no secret, or something that's been under a tree, that there's been a separation in the work of this ministry here in West Virginia from the ministry of Restoration Ministries in Jamaica over the last decade. And it's been my desire, been my sincere desire, to see this breach brought together and closed up. Sadly, while we have held to our prior positions, and of course some people would say we're not advancing in truth because we've held to our prior positions, but if our position was based in truth, friends, we don't need to move.
Amen.
But while our position has been in one solid place, Restoration Ministries has moved in a different direction. One, I sincerely believe that they think is correct. One, I sincerely believe that they think is needed. But make no mistake about it, friends, this is a new theology.
Amen.
It is no longer Adventism as we know it. And if the Adventism that we have known is error, then we must discard it and move ahead, becoming something that Restoration Ministries calls a Bible-based Christian or Christianity. But if Adventism is true, how dare we move from the platform of eternal truth?
Amen.
Now, there are some troubling areas of theology that Restoration Ministries has ventured into. And I will not attempt to critique all their teachings today. We wouldn't have the time. It's not the place. But there is one example of a teaching of theirs that we want to look at and compare it with a principle that this very ministry taught 15 years ago, and see if we cannot be edified by Restoration Ministries' work of 15 years ago. Isn't that fair? But first, their current position. For those who have been reading Open Face or listening to their positions from this ministry for the last few years, they will notice that they have ceased quoting from the writings of Ellen White and attempt to sustain all their positions from just the Bible. This is not wrong of itself. The testimonies in the Bible are not in conflict or competition with each other. But of course, the issue of correct interpretation, that is an issue, that is important. And in the most currently published Open Face, we read these words. One thing I've discovered about Ellen White's writings is that I can find statements to support all that I teach and believe there. But for the past few years, I have deliberately refused to support what I believe in this way. First of all, I think it is setting a bad example. If I hold to the Bible as my ultimate authority, I should not be acting contrary to my convictions. Secondly, I know that for every statement I find to support what I believe, somebody will find another one to contradict it. I am sorry, but this is the way it is, and anyone who is not aware of this is simply very unfamiliar with Ellen White's writings. I first began to see this clearly in the Godhead controversy, and now I see it in many other areas. So I don't want to be hypocritical and quote to support my point of view when I know that there are statements which equally contradict my point of view. So the bottom line is, I have become a Bible-based Christian, and it is the best thing that has ever happened to me. They make no bones, they make no excuse about this, and they've published it, so I don't think it's a problem if I just simply repeat their statement. But if not outright saying so, the implication, at minimum, is that the writings of Ellen White are unreliable, and instead of giving the trumpet that certain sound, they are two-faced, or even worse, that they are presenting multiple views of many doctrinal positions from equally strong points of view. Now, I said that we would look at a principle that Restoration Ministries taught and expounded 15 years ago, and we will shortly. But let me first state that the Bible teaches the doctrine of spiritual gifts. And to deny the spiritual gifts is then, in fact, to deny the Bible.
Amen.
Our pioneers understood this principle. For instance, Elder J.N. Andrews, probably the smartest person we've ever had in our church, he said this: "Now it is plain that those who reject the work of the Spirit of God under the plea that the Scriptures are sufficient do deny and reject all that part of the Bible which reveals the office and work of the Holy Spirit." Thus, 1 Corinthians 12 and Ephesians 4, which define the gifts of the Spirit of God, cannot really form a part of the rule of life of those who affirm that the Scriptures are so sufficient in themselves that the gifts of the Spirit are unnecessary. In fact, our Adventist pioneers so unanimously believed this that they published it in their fundamental statements of belief. For instance, statement number 16 in the 1872 statement said this: "That the Spirit of God was promised to manifest itself in the church through certain gifts, enumerated especially in 1 Corinthians 12 and Ephesians 4, that these gifts are not designed to supersede or take the place of the Bible, which is sufficient to make us wise unto salvation, any more than the Bible can take the place of the Holy Spirit. That, in specifying the various channels of its operation, that Spirit is simply made provision for its own existence and presence with the people of God to the end of time, to lead to an understanding of that word which it had inspired to convince of sin and to work a transformation in heart and life, and that those who deny to the Spirit its place and operation do plainly deny that part of the Bible which assigns to it this work and position." Did you get it? In other words, if we really claim to believe the Bible, then we have to believe in spiritual gifts, because it is the Bible, friends, that teaches the spiritual gifts. It's, without the Bible, we would have no proof that the spiritual gifts are real or could exist. The Bible does indeed teach the doctrine of spiritual gifts, and especially the gift of prophecy. Both Andrews and the statement made reference to Ephesians 4. Let's turn to Ephesians 4, and we'll read verses 11 through 14. Ephesians 4, verses 11 through 14. "And he gave some apostles and some," what? "Prophets, and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God into a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive." You see, friends, one of the great and primary purposes of these gifts is so that we're not blown around by every wind of doctrine. But I thought doctrine came from just the Bible. But spiritual gifts, friends, have a relationship to helping us as we understand that Bible.
Amen.
That's right.
Otherwise, what Paul wrote here has no meaning whatsoever. The spiritual gifts that God gave to the body are to edify the body. And the body, of course, is the total of parts, with the individual members being the parts that make up the body. And this edifying brings the body to the unity of the faith and perfection. And one of the products of spiritual gifts is that we be no more children tossed to and fro, carried about by every wind of doctrine. And so, friends, if we do not recognize spiritual gifts and how they can keep us out of doctrinal error when the winds blow, then we are not following all of the Bible. We can certainly say that we're going to believe only the Bible, but the Bible teaches these spiritual gifts. And in some way or ways, spiritual gifts help us to stay on a biblically correct doctrinal path.
Amen.
1 Corinthians 12, it also teaches that there are diversities of gifts, but they come from the one Spirit. Not all believers get the same gift. But the gift of prophecy is certainly one of those gifts. And in 1 Corinthians 14:1, Paul says, "Follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that ye may prophesy." The New King James translates it this way. It says, "Pursue love, desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy." Certainly, we must heed this counsel. And Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 20, he says, "Despise not prophesying." Despise not prophesying. That's a biblical command. To do otherwise is to not follow the Bible. Now let's talk about this principle. I said there was a principle that Restoration Ministries taught 15 years ago. In a sermon entitled "Reasons to Doubt, Reasons to Believe," it was stated that many of the same reasons people use to cast doubt upon the spirit of prophecy could be used to cast doubt upon the Bible.
Amen.
For example, some people say that the spirit of prophecy teaches multiple views on some specific subjects and that it contradicts itself. This is what was taught 15 years ago. It's a good lesson. We should listen to it. But it was correctly brought out in this principle 15 years ago that the Bible does not contradict itself. Any apparent contradictions are simply there because we do not fully understand the Bible. We just don't know how to put it together yet well enough. Let me give you a few examples. Concerning death, we could read this. Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 21 through 23, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor, yet what I shall choose I want not. For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better." Did Paul really write that? Well, he sure did, didn't he? Jesus told a story. And that story is recorded in Luke chapter 16. And in that story, he taught about a beggar, Lazarus, and a rich man. "And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried." Verse 23. "And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame." Does the Bible really teach that? It does, doesn't it? You can read it. It's in your Bible.
Yes.
But of course, it's not the only thing the Bible says. The Bible also says this in Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 5. "For the living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything, neither have they any more reward, for the memory of them is forgotten." And then there's Psalms chapter 6 and verse 5. "For in death there is no remembrance of thee, in the grave who shall give thee thanks?" And then there's Psalms 146 and verse 4. It says, "His breath goeth forth, he returneth to his earth, in that very day his thoughts perish." And there's also Job 14:21. "His sons come to honor, and he knoweth it not, and they are brought low, but he perceiveth it not of them." And then I like this one from Daniel chapter 12 and verse 2. "And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting content." You get the point though, don't you? While there are some texts that seem to speak differently, the weight of evidence is clearly that the dead know nothing on our estate that the Bible compares to being asleep. Jesus spoke of this in John chapter 11. Paul writes about it in 1 Corinthians 4:13 and 1 Thessalonians 4:13 and 1 Corinthians 15 verses 18 and 20. But this isn't the only subject that we could see work like this. There are texts that seem to speak differently, for instance, on the destiny of the wicked. For example, right in the third angel's message, Revelation 14:11, "And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day or night who worship the beast in his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name." In Isaiah 66, in verse 24, the Bible says, "And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me. For their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched, and they shall be an whoring unto all flesh." Does the Bible really say that? Well, it does, doesn't it? But it says more. We can also read this in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 9. "And they went upon the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about in the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them." 1 John chapter 5 and verse 12, "He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life." John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him won't burn in hell forever." Is that what it says?
No.
"Shall not perish, should not perish, but have everlasting life." Or what about this one, Romans 6:23, "The wages of sin is death." That's right. We could speak about atonement. You know, in Romans chapter 5 and verse 11, Paul writes this, He says, and not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. That's what it says, Romans 5:11. And some would teach that the atonement was completed at the cross. But we could also read this, Leviticus 16:30. For on that day, the day of atonement, for on that day the priest shall make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that ye may be cleaned from all your sins before the Lord. We could read in 1 Corinthians 15, in verses 16 and 7. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, ye are yet in your sins. Friends, it couldn't have all been completed at the cross. Concerning the doctrine of God, we could read texts such as Matthew 28:19. Anybody know what it says? Matthew 28:19. We could read 2 Corinthians 13:14. Anybody remember what it says? We could read 1 John 5:7. Yeah, I bet you remember what that one says. Yeah. But we know that we have to understand these texts by the light of other scriptures as well. And yet, because we do not understand these things, we may be tempted to doubt the Bible. But no, we say, wait, no, we can't doubt the Bible. We know the Bible is the Word of God. And so we know there must be some way to fix these things, right? But for the same reasons we could doubt, and the same reasons that we could believe the Bible, friends, we could doubt or believe the testimony of Jesus, the Spirit of prophecy. We could read texts that seem to teach that we can eat meat. In fact, any meat that we want. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, there's that term, the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from meats which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. There you go. If you don't understand it, if you don't compare it with other verses, you might be confused, right? We might read Acts chapter 10, where Peter had this vision. And the Lord said, arise and eat. Remember? Mm-hmm. Peter says, Lord, I've never eaten anything common or unclean, because on this sheet that was let down was all kinds of abominable, unclean animals. And the Lord said, arise and eat. Did this three times. You see? We can read about church collections on the first day of the week in 1 Corinthians 16:2. And we can even use the Bible to teach that we should believe in tradition. You know, that's what the Catholic Church does. We say the Catholic Church teaches both the Bible and tradition. And they openly say, yes, we teach the Bible and the tradition. But you know, they use the Bible as the reason that they say they can teach tradition. Did you know that? For instance, in 2 Thessalonians 2:15, he says, therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistle. Well, maybe things that weren't in the epistles, things that weren't in the Bible. Those are traditions. Hold on to them, Paul says. And then, in chapter 3 and verse 6, now we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly, and not after the tradition which he received of us. At least that's what Stephen King's Doctrinal Catechism gives us a reference. You see. But again, friends, we understand that there is a harmony of the Scriptures. If there appears to be a contradiction, it's simply a lack of our understanding the matter properly. Now, if I was writing the Bible, would I have stated Revelation 14:11 like it is? Would I have written Philippians 1:23 like it is? Would I have made them different? In my ignorance, I'm sure I would have. But I'm thankful, friends, that God didn't trust me with such a task. And though we may not see the wisdom of the way that God has given His Word to us, I assure you it's exactly the way as He wants it and needs it to be. And if we discard the Bible because we don't see how to harmonize various texts, the problem is with us, it's not with the Bible. Sure. However, we do have to understand that there is a weight of evidence, and that weight will help us to understand how we approach these and other such passages. And friends, the same is true in the spirit of prophecy. And with all my heart and soul and mind, I believe this concerning the writings of Ellen White, for they are the testimony of Jesus. Now there are references. There are references that seem to speak differently on the atonement, the incarnation, and the Godhead. There certainly are such references, but they are certainly not of equal weight or in copious number, as Open Face declares. Did Ellen White actually write, "In Christ is life, original, unborrowed, and derived. He that hath the Son hath life," 1 John 5:12. "The divinity of Christ is the believer's assurance of eternal life." Desire of Ages, page 530. Did Ellen White really write that? She sure did. But she also wrote this. In fact, she wrote this and published it the year before Desire of Ages was published. She says, "In him was life, original, unborrowed, underived. This life is not inherent in man. He can possess it only through Christ. He cannot earn it. It is given him as a free gift if he will believe in Christ as his personal Savior." Now, the reference is Selected Messages, but it actually was published in the book, in the periodical Signs of the Times, the year before Desire of Ages was published. She says that Christ has this life, original, unborrowed, and derived. But she says we can have this life. Now that doesn't make us a second person or a third or a multiple person of the Trinity or of any kind of triune God.
Amen.
She also wrote this. She said, "God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, not a son by creation, as were the angels, nor a son by adoption, as is the forgiven sinner, but a son begotten in the express image of the Father's person, and in all the brightness of his majesty and glory, one equal with God in authority, dignity, and divine perfection. In him dwelt all the fullness of the Godhead bodily." And so, we see that there's a weight of evidence, friends, and an understanding of how to apply these seemingly difficult references if we just will study them more. For instance, in the Review and Herald, September 24, 1901, she says, "He planted, that is Christ, planted the cross between heaven and earth, and when the Father beheld the sacrifice of his Son, he bowed before it in recognition of its perfection. It is enough, he said, the atonement is complete." The Father said that, and that's in quotation marks, friends. But it's understanding that that atonement, in this particular reference, refers to the sacrificial death on the cross, the atonement on the cross, because Ellen White also wrote this. "He next entered the most holy place to make an atonement for the sins of the people and to cleanse of the sanctuary. His work as high priest completes the divine plan of redemption by making the final atonement for sin." Amen. You see, there's another atonement. Mm-hmm. And so the writings aren't out of harmony, friends. It's our understanding or our lack of understanding that may be out of harmony. For instance, this one in early writings. "As the priest entered the most holy once a year to cleanse the earthly sanctuary, so Jesus entered the most holy of the heavenlies at the end of the 2300 days of Daniel 8 in 1844 to make a final atonement for all who could be benefited by his mediation and thus to cleanse the sanctuary." She also wrote this in Patriarchs and Prophets. Page 357. "The blood of Christ, while it was to release the repentant sinner from the condemnation of the law, was not to cancel the sin. It would stand on record in the sanctuary until the final atonement. So in the type, the blood of the sin offering removed the sin from the penitent, but it rested in the sanctuary until the day of atonement."
Amen.
And we could read this. You see, friends, the same way that inspiration works in the Bible, we find this also in the testimony of Jesus. Statements that don't always just sound real plain. Sometimes statements that are hard to be understood. You know, Peter said that Paul wrote things that were hard to be understood. But it doesn't mean that they're not inspired. And God has designed, through inspiration, the presentation of his word and his message in such a way that we'll always have a nail to hang our doubts on if we want it. To weed out those who really aren't sincere, who really don't want the truth. God's presenting such a big, complex picture that we have to carefully study it all so that we can have the most complete view and clear view of what his will is for man. Now today, I'm very glad for that study that was given 15 years ago by Restoration Ministries. For it's helped me. It's helped me to keep me balanced and steady concerning the gift foretold in Revelation chapter 12, 17, and Revelation 19, 10. And I would sincerely appeal to the brethren in Restoration Ministries to go back and consider this message and its counsel. The issue is not, friends, over whether we will quote the spirit of prophecy or use only the Bible for doctrine. No, the issue is if we are rejecting spiritual gifts that are taught in the Bible, the spiritual gifts that Christ has given His church, and the perilous danger that such rejection brings. Now, I've tested the writings of Ellen White for 40 years now, and I have found that they ring true. They have that certain sound. They're not hollow. Ask Stephen Smith, who received a testimony from Ellen White encouraging him to change things in his life. And he did not want to read the testimony. He became upset with Ellen White. How dare she try to rebuke him? He wouldn't even open her letter. He put it into a trunk. But in that letter, she wrote, "If you refuse to heed the counsel of God, here's what's going to happen in your life." 28 years later, he opened that trunk and found that letter, and he opened it. And it read exactly the history of his life for the last 28 years. But you know what? It worked a reformation in his life, and he came back to the Lord. How did she know 28 years before what was going to happen in his life? God had shown her, friends. History records many, many such stories and events that reveal Ellen White was used in a supernatural way by God. If you just read her books, books like Patriarchs and Prophets, The Desire of Ages, and The Great Controversy, you see that they clearly lift up Jesus and His teachings like books from no other author. Amen. Beloved, Ellen White claimed to have visions and dreams from God. She was faithful in relating these dreams and visions. But if we believe that she was a false prophet, if we believe that she taught error, if we believe that she really did not have these dreams and visions, then we should just plainly state as such and not be hypocritical. We are told in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, page 300, "The subjects of the Sabbath, the nature of man, and the testimony of Jesus are the great and important truths to be understood. These will prove as an anchor to hold God's people in these perilous times." The Sabbath, the state of the dead, and especially the testimony of Jesus, that these will prove an anchor to hold God's people in these perilous times. Now, anchors keep us from drifting away from where we need to be. They will help keep us from being blown away by every wind of doctrine. And arguably, her greatest book, The Great Controversy, teaches that the beast of Revelation 13 is the papacy. Now, I didn't need Ellen White's book to do that, to know that. Adventists, for 170 years, have been teaching that. They've been holding evangelistic meetings, and they've been teaching that the Roman Catholic Church is the beast of Revelation 13 from the Bible, and the Bible alone, comparing the Bible, of course, with historical events, the prophecies unfolding. And I've been to many, many evangelistic meetings. I've held evangelistic meetings, and I've never been to an evangelistic meeting, and I never held an evangelistic meeting where we preached from the beast of Revelation 13 and we ever once quoted Ellen White's writings. We simply did it from the Bible. But friends, if we miss the testimony of Jesus on this, we could get so far out and discard our view of the papacy. In fact, in Open Face it says, "The beast of Revelation 13 is not the papacy, as I was always taught, but that it represented a political empire and not a church." You see, when you start to move one point, how everything else starts to get skewed, even something so fundamental as saying that the beast of Revelation 13 is not the papacy, friends, this is not Adventism in any way, shape, or form. I'm sorry.
Amen.
It's not. We may think that we have a better way than that which is laid out for us in the spirit of prophecy, but friends, this is not the case. God has foreseen all of this mess that people have been in and are now in, and He's written counsel for His people to warn them. In Testimonies for the Church, Volume 4, page 211. It is Satan's plan. It is Satan's plan. Don't forget this, friends. It is Satan's plan to weaken the faith of God's people in the testimonies. Next follows skepticism in regard to the vital points of our faith, the pillars of our position, then doubt as to the Holy Scriptures, and then the downward march to perdition. And then this following warning was given over 100 years ago, but it's still so vital today. The enemy has made his mastery efforts to unsettle the faith of our own people in the testimonies. And when these errors come in, they claim to prove all the positions by the Bible. But they misinterpret the Scriptures. They make bold assertions, as did Elder Canright, and misapply the prophecies and the Scriptures to prove falsehood, especially the prophecies, you see. And after men have done their work in weakening the confidence of our churches in the testimonies, they've torn away the barrier that unbelief in the truth shall become widespread, and there is no voice to be lifted up to stay the force of error. This is just as Satan designed it should be. And those who have been preparing the way for the people to pay no heed to the warnings and reproofs of the testimonies of the Spirit of God will see that a tide of errors of all kind will spring into life. And they certainly are. Amen. They certainly are. She says also, they will claim Scripture as their evidence, and deceptions of Satan in every form will prevail. Beloved, Satan usually doesn't work openly, taking a sledgehammer to truth, for he knows that were that to happen, that many people would be repulsed by such an attack. Instead, he takes a little pick and he chips away a little here, a little there. He is insistent and non-tiring in his work until we finally become ready to accept what we at one time would never have dreamed of believing. In Selected Messages, Book 1, we are told Satan is constantly pressing in the spurious to lead away from the truth. The very last deception of Satan will be to make of none effect the testimony of the Spirit of God. Where there is no vision, the people perish, Proverbs 29:18. Satan will work ingeniously in different ways and through different agencies to unsettle the confidence of God's remnant people in the true testimony. And then she says this from another letter, also in Selected Messages. There will be a hatred kindled against the testimonies which is satanic. The workings of Satan will be to unsettle the faith of the churches in them for this reason. Satan cannot have so clear a track to bring in his deception and bind up souls in his delusions if the warnings and reproofs and counsels of the Spirit of God are heeded. I learned a good lesson 15 years ago, and I'm thankful for that lesson. And I don't want to let go of that lesson because it was a true lesson. And it's my prayer that those who have forgotten this lesson will go back and restudy it and consider it.
Amen.
I think the most famous words that Jehoshaphat said are so applicable to us today. And they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, "Hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall ye prosper." Friends, that is truth. That is present truth today. It's present truth that each one of us needs to take heed to, and will be to the peril of our soul if we don't. May God have mercy upon us. May we be faithful to the call that he has given to us as a people to bear the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And maybe I could just say one more thing. We sometimes take this idea that that the testimony of Jesus can be anything we want it to be. If God inspires me with his Spirit, I have the testimony of Jesus. But in the book of Revelation, the testimony of Jesus, friends, is being a prophet. It's being a prophet. And maybe you think you're a prophet today, or maybe someone else thinks they're a prophet today. And if God's spoken to them, then they are. But friends, it can't contradict the established truth that we already have.
Amen.
There's nothing wrong with new light. There's nothing wrong with more light. Proverbs 4:18 says that the path of the just is as a shining light that shineth brighter and brighter until the perfect day. There's always going to be more truth. We're going to be learning about truth throughout eternity. But it will never contradict the truth that has been established already. Don't ever forget that. May God add His blessing, friends, because we need it desperately today.